All right, so we are going to go through, let's see, we're going to go through layer masks, text layers, fill layers, layer styles, smart objects, smart filters, blend modes, adjustment layers. Well, can't really type today. Adjustment layers. What's next? Shape layers and layer comps. So this is everything that we're going to go through. We'll go through some of them a little more in depth than others, but with that, we'll go ahead and get started. So right here, I have just kind of the blank Photoshop canvas. We'll get that out of the way. And we're gonna go to File, New, and I myself do a lot of video work, and so we are going to go to just a 4K film setup, fairly high resolution, whatever your project needs to be. We're just gonna label it, well, we'll just label it Tutorial. Okay, so we'll click OK. It'll take a sec and it will open our document. So here we have our document. I'll assume that you're familiar with navigating around and being able to drag your screen around and things like that. So let's start by bringing in a few images. I have a few images of some of my friends and then me and one of my friends. So we're gonna bring those in, and these images can be really anything you need them to be. These are just three that I saw right offhand and said, hey, those will work. So we're gonna go through, and first let's go over layer masks. So layer masking is essentially a way to non-destructively erase the photo. But before we do that, we're actually gonna go through it and we're gonna rasterize all these. You can see how they have this funny little icon down in the bottom. It doesn't really do us too much good. And so what we're gonna do is I'm just gonna highlight those and I'm gonna right click over and make sure you click in the text and not the image. And we're just gonna go to rasterize layers, and it'll just make it so they're a little bit nicer to play with. So what we're gonna do is, I'm gonna turn off these bottom two, and so if we turn off that top one, you see that's the only one we have, available to us. So if I go to and click on the erase tool, you can see we just have a fairly standard erase brush, and I begin to erase on that image. But let's say, oh wait, I want to bring that back. There really is no way to bring that back, unless you can undo, like I just did there with Command Z. If you're several steps down the line, if it's too many to go back and undo, to finally get back to that original image, you're kind of stuck, and you have to bring that image again in again and maybe start over. So layer masks can help us in a way that's non-destructive to the photos, something that we can bring back, something that we can undo very easily. So with that image selected, I'm going to go down and click on this mask button down here, the rectangle with a circle in it. And so what you see is that has now added just this white blank sheet over next to it. And you may say, okay, well, that didn't do anything. If I erase, it's still not doing much for me. If you have that selected. But let's make sure you go over and click on that white sheet so you can see kind of this border around it. It's selected now, not the image. Make sure it's the white sheet. And then if you actually take the paint tool, and I don't know, we'll just go to a fairly standard brush, a hard brush. We'll bring that size up a little bit. And let's go ahead and just make that black, make our color black. Now you can see with this layer mask selected, if we begin to paint black on the image, then it'll erase just as the erase tool did. However, what it's done is you can now see over here just this tiny little strip of black in there. Let's do a little bit more so it's a little bit bigger so you can see it. So what that's done is, and that's cut a hole in the layer mask where it's saying everything that's black, erase that part of the image. Everything that's white, keep that part of the image. And so, again, you may say, okay, well, what has this done to help us? Why is this different than the erase tool? Because now we can go back in, and since that part is black, we say, oh wait, I wanna undo that. So we're just gonna swap our colors there. And you see if we begin to paint with white with the same brush in there, we can make the brush bigger if we need. then you can see it paints that image back in. And now if you look, you know, that image, and you can see we painted a little bit outside the image there, but now you can see that our image is whole again, and we can go in, you know, we can do that several different ways. You know, if we don't want to erase the complete image, you know, but we just want to make it a little transparent, you know, let's make it a little bit gray. We can do that, and you can see that it's only erasing part of the image. It's making it a little bit transparent. And so, and that was just undo there, Command Z. And so you can see really that complete white will keep the image, complete black will erase the image. And it's really a good non-destructive way to edit the photos, meaning that we can go back, you know, you're not destroying anything original. It's always something you can undo that you can edit later. So that's really all you need to be concerned about with layer masks and being able to edit them. So what I'm going, we're actually going to keep that there just in case we need to go back to it. So next on the list is a text layer. And text layers are very, very simple. You can see over here on our tool palette on our side, if we just select that text tool, and if you click and hold down, you see we get different tools, but I'm just going to select the standard text tool, and I'm just going to drag just a text box in there, and you can see we've made a fairly big one. And these are my friends Chris and Mariah in our picture here, so we'll just type Chris and Mariah. And you can see, oh wait, you know, where's our text? Well, we can see up here that my color is white. So why don't we go ahead and just change that to kind of a deep blue. There we go. That's always something to pay attention to. If your text doesn't show up, make sure you check the color of your text or the size of your text. Sometimes it'll be far too big and it won't appear in the text box. You have to make the text box larger or the text smaller. So that's something to keep in mind. And then I think we'll just, I don't know, we'll increase our size here to maybe 200 point. And with that selected, we'll just center that in the text box. Now keep in mind that that center does not center it in the actual canvas. That just centers it in the text box. So if you double click on this text layer over here, you can go back into edit if you've deselected it. So we can see, you know, like let's just shrink that text box down just to illustrate this. If I click center, you see it only centers it in the text box. It does not center it in the canvas. So, you know, be wary of that. Usually if I want to center something, I'm a big fan of using guides. This is just kind of a little cheat that's easy to use, you know, that'll help you a lot. That's actually not on that list, but you know, we'll throw it in there anyways, is if you make sure you go into, now I've got to remember where it is. There we go, it's in View Rulers. So if you go to View Rulers, you'll get kind of these markings on the side here. And you know, like you can set these units, but if you click inside one of them and drag out, then you see we can drag, you know, we can kind of drag this guide here. And so if we look, my canvas is 56.889, close enough, is about 57, I believe this is in inches wide. And so, you know, if we divide 57 by 2, you know, which my math isn't, you know, super up there right now, but it looks like 28 is about center, so we'll go with that. So you can see if I just drag there and let go, you know, it's kind of added this guide in, and you can do the same from the top, you know, and go down and things like that. And so that's a really easy way to do it. So if you just take your canvas and divide it in half, you know, and drag a ruler to about there, then it's really easy to center things in there, you know, and you can kind of see, okay, you know, that's about centered. If you want to get rid of them, you know, just hover over it and just drag it up to the top or off to the side, you know, back towards the ruler, and it'll go away. That's just kind of a handy trick to know. But text layers, so you can see when we created that text box, you select this, you know, we now get this new text layer over here denoted by a T, and then, you know, we can rename this, you know, just to stay organized, and you see it doesn't affect this. It just by default, whatever the text you have in there will be the name. And so, you know, now that I have it deselected, let's say I want to go back and edit it. Well, if you just double click on that T, you can see it'll bring us back into edit mode. And there's several different things we can do. You know, like we can go and we can hover through different fonts with the text selected. If the text is not selected, it won't make a difference. But, you know, we can go through different fonts. Some will have, you know, bolds and italics, you know, others will just have regular, you know, it's really up to you. We can change the size. One that's good to know that can be kind of a something tricky to come across is this curve tool. And it says here it's warp text, but you can see, you know, if we wanted that text in an arc, and you can see we've clicked that button, you know, and there's several different things we can do here. We can go arc, you know, and we can play with that and, you know, kind of make it stylized, whatever, you know, really kind of whatever you want, whatever floats your boat. That's just in case, you know, you kind of want to make your text a little more stylized. For me, we're just going to keep it kind of that fairly flat, you know, just plain text. So, you know, if you jump back to just our move tool, kind of the standard tool there, you can see we can move the text around, call it good. I never recommend scaling the text, seeing as how if you do it dramatically enough, then it will, you know, it will pixelate the text. We got to that transform menu by Command T. Anything I say with a command applies to Control in Windows. I'm on a Mac, and so the modifier key is Command. So you can see, you know, you can kind of adjust things there. If you hold down Shift, it'll do it proportionally. So that's another good one to know. Just hit Enter when you're done. I would always recommend, though, to make your text bigger. You know, make sure your text box is adequate size, and then just increase your point on the font, the size of the font, and that will just make sure that the text stays crisp the whole way, like as you make it larger. That's just a good one to keep in mind. So those are text layers, and you can see that as we drag down, you know, it goes over that text. But, you know, let's say we wanted it to kind of appear behind that text. Well, the way to do that is, you know, I mean, yeah, you could do that, you know, and carefully erase along that line, but that's so much work, you know. And then again, it's like, what if you want it back, you know, and you don't want to do a text mask? Well, there's so many easier ways to do it, you know, is over here in our layers panel. You can see there's our image, you know, this is our image. And so if we select that and simply drag it above the friends layer, then you'll see right now, you know, they're not overlapping, so it didn't really make a difference. But if I select our friends layer and now begin to drag it down, then you can see it goes behind the text, or behind the image, I'm sorry. The text goes behind the image. And that's simply because, well, the image is on top of the text. If you think about, you know, you're looking through a camera here, you know, and you're looking at all these layers stacked on top of each other, those layers are essentially, if you just look at the camera down through here, so whatever's on top will obscure whatever's behind it, et cetera, as you go down. You know, and so obviously if we erase part of that image, or using our layer mask, you know, let's go in and let's just do that, then you can see as we drag our text down, it's no longer obscured by that part of the image since we erased it. So that's just a basic introduction to how layers work, layers themselves, you know, and it's always a good idea to keep everything, pretty much everything that's a separate element on a different layer. You know, it's like, yes, these, I have a bunch of images in here, but they're all on different layers, and so it's easier to go edit them individually and drag them around, you know, rather than having, you know, all these images on the same layer and all this text on the same layer and things like that. And Photoshop's pretty good about when you create something new, then it will, you know, it will apply it to a new layer by default. But there's sometimes, you know, where you can get a few things on one layer, especially if you're, you know, especially if you're drawing in Photoshop, then, you know, you tend to draw like this mountain, you know, and then this tree and then this, and you tend to draw it all on the same layer. It's best to try and keep things that are separate elements on different layers. It's just kind of a good way to work, you know, it keeps you very organized. So next we're going to jump to a fill layer, and fill layers are very basic, you know, but they can do a lot to help us out. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to go down here in the very bottom corner, and just on that kind of on that peeling page, that's the new layer button. So we're just going to title this fill layer. All I did was double click on that text there. And so with that selected, we can go over and select the paint bucket tool, you know, or if you have, some of you might have the gradient tool there. It's all, you know, it's all in the same submenu. If you click and hold, you know, we're going to go out to the paint bucket tool. And let's do a red layer. So we're just going to drag up there, you know, we'll do kind of a, I don't know, medium red there. And so I'll click OK, and so our red is there now. And with that layer selected, just that empty layer, if we just click in there with the paint bucket tool, you can say, you know, you see, oh my goodness, it's filled our entire canvas with red. And that's really all fill layers are just a basic, You know, just a basic solid color. Although, you know, like fill layers can apply to gradients as well. You can see, you know, let's have a red to white gradient there. And I don't know, we'll stay on just a, I don't know, let's do a circular gradient just for fun. And I'll click and drag, and that's the center point of the gradient. And then out to here is where we finally reach the second color. So from this point to this second point, it's fading from 100% red from the first point to 100% white at the second point. So you can see I've left my cursor right there. Then you can see all the way out here is where it finally reaches right, that white. Right back here, it's still a little bit red, you know, and as we go back in, it fades and fades and fades until we get to 100% red right in the center. So that's what gradients do. But you see, we applied this gradient and, you know, well, here's the white, but where's our image? Well, this is still a solid layer. This is still, you know, this is still colored white. It's not transparent. And so let's say we wanted that as our background. Well, let's, you know, let's go ahead and let's just drag this down. And, you know, you can go through and you can edit this background layer down here. I usually keep, you know, I usually delete it or just kind of keep it there, you know, just to make sure there's some sort of a background there and we don't get something that's transparent, which you'll see is denoted by these checks. That shows that it's transparent. There is nothing there. So I usually just keep the background layer there and just don't mess with it. And so if we, you know, if we turn that back on, so you see we dragged our filler from the top where it was obscuring everything to down to the bottom, which when I say bottom is still above the background. And you'll see now that it's behind everything we've created. You know, let's say, oh, you know, I wanted to, you know, I wanted to create an entirely, you know, an entirely solid red layer. Well, if you go back in and you select the paint bucket tool, you know, and have that red and you select out here, well, all that's done, you know, is it's kind of created this weird, you know, this weird effect. And what that's done is when, you know, when we did that, we clicked in this white space, it's only going to fill pixels that are 100% white. So you see everything in here, even though it may look white, still has a tiny bit of red in it, you know, and you click there and you click there and stuff, but it's, you know, it's still kind of a little bit, you know, a little bit off. And so what you can do is one of the easiest ways, and this is a way where you can destructively edit because it's easy, it's either easy to get back or, you know, it's you just didn't want it in the first place, is, you know, if we select the erase tool and with our fill layer selected, you know, we just kind of erase in there and make it so we have a completely white background again. So I'm going to go down and select our paint bucket tool, and with that fill layer selected, you know, and you can see it did that because we erased the white in there as well. But you know, and usually it's a good idea, in fact, to even just go in and create a completely new layer. And, you know, with that red, there you go. So you can see we just snapped that whole image in. You know, we can do that with any color, you know, oh, wait, I wanted it, green, you know, then now it's green. I think we'll actually make it kind of a nice, you know, kind of a nice golden orange, a little bit yellow. Here we go. So now you can see those are fill layers. That's just kind of the basics of how to operate those. Layer styles. So if we go up to, I haven't used layer styles in a long time, but you know, they can be useful. And so, you know, let's say our image here, you know, we want to apply a layer style to that. So we're just going to select on, you know, we're just going to select that layer, and you can always see which layers are visible as denoted by the eye down here. You can see these bottom ones are not visible because they don't have the eye next to them. And it's easy, you know, to turn that off to isolate different elements of your image. So with our image, with our visible image selected, we're going to go to layer. We're going to go down to layer styles, and you can see there's several different things we can do. Some of them are going to have, you know, a little bit more of a profound effect than others. So you can see, like, let's zoom in here just so we're a little bit closer. So let's go depth, you know, we'll increase that. And you can see what this is doing, you know, if we do that really quickly, is just kind of creating this slight bevel around the edge, an almost 3D effect. You know, if we just make that depth and then, you know, if we increase the size, there you can really see it. You know, and it's creating quite a bit of, you know, like quite the dramatic effect. You know, we can do a soften, and so it's more of a rounded corner, or bring it all the way down, you know, and it's a little bit sharper corner. And then you can see, you know, we have shadow on this side and kind of highlights right there. That's because our light is set to come from about that angle. And you can see, you know, as we drag that around, you know, and then release to let, you know, to let go, you can see that it'll kind of adjust that lighting angle, you know, and as you drag it further into the center here, the light will be more head on versus, you know, up here on the very top of that circle, you know, it will be a light that comes from a very steep angle against this image. You know, you can do different contours and things like that. So how that edge, you know, how that edge reacts. And I mean, like some of them you can see, you know, are giving us very, very dramatic effects just based on, you know, kind of how we work with this image here. And those are things you really just kind of have to play around with and see, because essentially what it's telling us is if we turn this on its side and looked at this edge in a profile, that's what it would look like. And it's hard to tell here, I agree. But, you know, for us, we'll just keep it like that. You know, we'll adjust that lighting just a little bit. There we go. You know, that'll work for what we need. So I'm just going to click OK. And that's now a layer style, you know, but you can apply multiple layer styles. Like, you know, I want that to appear like it's not sitting on here, you know, I want there to be a little bit of a shadow. So with that layer still selected, I'm going to go layer, we're going to go layer style, we're going to go down to drop shadow. Drop shadow is one I do use a lot. You know, it just kind of gives things a nice effect, you know, very pleasing to the eye, things like that. And so, you can see it's already added it a tiny bit. You can see if I click the preview on and off, then right up in here, you know, you can see that little bit of a drop shadow clicking on and off. So with the preview on, you know, I'm just going to start adjusting some of these parameters. So you can see the distance, you know, is how far away it is. And you can see, you know, the image almost, it's not, it seems this orange is more in the background now, you know, instead of right behind this image, you know, because it's now casting a shadow. You know, spread, things like that, you know, it's kind of the softening of the shadow in a way. The size is, it changes like how far the image fades, and so I guess really that could be softening, and spread is more of an expansion, I guess would be a better way to describe it. And so, you know, we want like a fairly soft shadow, we'll make it pretty far back, and you can change the opacity, and so it's not as harsh of a shadow. You know, or you can make it really dark. You know, it's kind of up to you and whatever, you know, whatever you're after. So I don't know, we'll bring it in right there. And that's a good way. And instead of going back and, you know, doing layer styles and layer styles and layer styles, while you're in here, if you know what you want to do, you know, you can simply click on one and see there's stroke, you know, and you can just turn it on and off with that checkbox there. Inner shadow, that won't affect us too much on this image, really. You can see it a little bit on the side. Color overlay, you know, there's so many different things, there's so many different things you can do, and a lot of them is really just going in and just playing with it and see, you know, what does this do, what does this do, you know, and that's really how you learn Photoshop, is just going in, you know, and checking each one of these and saying, okay, stroke, you know, there's now a border around it, you know, so let's play with the size, you know, that makes it bigger, the opacity, you know, and things like that. And that's really how you can, you learn Photoshop, is just kind of by playing with things. So, you know, here we have our bevel and our emboss, which, you know, kind of made this shape around the corner, you know, made it a little more 3D, and then we added our drop shadow, as you can see here. So we're just going to click OK, and you can see now that this layer has expanded a good deal. And if it didn't, you know, if it still looks the same, you should now have this arrow over here that you can click on. It should drop that down. So you can see we can turn all our effects on or off, or we can turn them off, you know, individually. So you can see we can turn that bevel and emboss off, or our drop shadow. And so what that, you know, that just allows you to kind of isolate things a little bit and see, you know, yes, I do want that. No, I don't want that. You know, and again, just kind of staying organized within your image. And another little side note, because Photoshop is oftentimes, you know, you want to work fast, you know, you want to be efficient. And so if we right click on this layer, if you right click on the image, it won't work. You get two different menus. If you right click on the image versus the layer, you know, kind of out here by the text, you can see you get two different menus. If you, you know, like if you right click there And if you go to blending options, that will actually bring up that same layer style menu. And so you don't have to go to layer, layer style, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And that also works if you want to, you know, if you want to edit those, if you want to say, oh, I want to bring my drop shadow back further, click on the drop shadow, distance, click OK, you know, and there you go. Rather than having to apply one, you know, and go in and change it and things like that. So that's just kind of a quick, efficient way to work in Photoshop. So next one, smart objects. Those are ones that, you know, I'll admit that I don't work with a ton. What we're going to do, though, is we're just going to bring up a different one of our images here. Oops. Says we don't have a layer selected, so we have to make sure we have something selected before we can actually do anything with it. So I am going to, if we right click, let's see, if we right click on that image and, or on the layer, I'm sorry, and click convert to smart object, that will actually bring back that little thing that we have down there, called rasterize. That just means the image is, unrasterized, which, just has a lot to do with the math and kind of how the pixels are being calculated, providing my memory serves correctly. It's nothing that's terribly important what it does. All we know is that with that, it is now, smart layer. So a smart object, I should say. And right after that, we have smart filters, which is now, you know, and we can go up, like, let's say, you know, oh, I don't know where, you know, smart filters are. No, I do. You know, if we do, you know, if we start searching, you can go smart, you know, smart filter, and it says, you know, oh, well, you know, here over here in layer, you know, we don't have smart filters available. I actually am, like, honest to goodness, not, I don't actually remember what smart filters do and, like, why they're important and things like that. You know, if we jump back and we go layer smart filter, I honestly don't know what they do. So we're going to kind of, like, pretend and just gloss over that part. The reason I'm making this tutorial for a friend, look in your book, see what it says about it, because I have never used them. That's kind of why I don't know how to use them. It's just because I've never used them in the type of work I do. So I'm really sorry about that, but take a look in the book, and you know, I'll do some research as well, because that's probably something I ought to know. That's kind of embarrassing that I'm making a Photoshop tutorial and I don't actually know some of those things. But we'll go through and we'll bang out the rest of these, because I know that I do know the rest of these. Anyways, so blending modes, you know, let's jump back to our original image here. And so we're going to go to, now that we're on that image, blending modes are, I don't know, different ways that the image can be calculated with things around it. And it's, blending modes are kind of hard to explain. There's something you really have to go through and again, see what each one does, you know, because all of them have certain mathematical properties behind them. You know, multiply will multiply, like, the darkest pixels by the lightest pixels, I think is what it does, and things like that. And, you know, that doesn't really mean anything, you know, unless you're, you know, really into the program, you know, really understand how, you know, each pixel interacts with the next. But if you go, you know, like, if you go in and just play with it, because I know what multiply does is, it usually, if I have something with white on the background, you know, just a logo on white, if I switch it to multiply, it will actually take that white out, you know, and just kind of leave the logo. But, you know, you can see if I switch that to multiply, how it's taken pretty much anything, you know, any light color, anything that was white out, and it's almost made that, you know, kind of like transparent to that orange. It's made parts of it transparent. And, you know, that's partly because I just have a trained eye and things like that, but, you know, blending modes are things you have to play with, and there's two ways to change them. You can see what I did there was I right-clicked on there and went into that same blending options menu that brings up that layer styles panel, you know, where you can see there's our drop shadow and our bevel and emboss. And so, you know, by the default is blending options up top will be selected, and there's blend mode right here, and you can drop down, you can see there's all sorts of different ones. You know, I know that screen takes out blacks or darker colors, And so you can see, you know, it's now essentially taken anything that was dark in this image and kind of made it transparent to that orange. And so there's, you know, there's several different things. And like I said, it's just go through and play with them. You know, there's darken, there's, you know, there's color burn. And so some of these will give you, you know, very dramatic effects. You know, some of them, you know, some of them aren't quite as, you know, quite as dramatic, things like that. And so, and they each interact in different ways. And so, you know, like in this case, it might be a good idea. You know, let's go down and let's go just really quick. This isn't part of the tutorial, but it'll help us out a little bit. So I'm just going to create a solid filled black rectangle and then a solid filled white rectangle. And we're gonna put them behind our image. You know, we're gonna drag that up a little bit. Just so we can see kind of how different blending modes interact with different backgrounds. So again, blending options. We're gonna go, you know, like let's go to darken, you know. And so it's like, I even have to go back to reference to see, you know, what each one of these do. And it looks like they're not really playing very nice with what we've got here. And that may be because they're shapes. You know, let's jump to rasterized layers and I don't know, let's try it again, see if that works a little bit better. Okay, and so, and blending modes are based a lot on black and white, is something that I forgot to mention. And so maybe here's, you know, and like different grayscale values. And so here's what we'll do instead. You know, let's just make that a red, and then let's make our white one, you know, let's make it kind of this aqua blue. And let's see, you know, let's see if that makes a difference, you know, multiply. Okay, there we go. That's why I was having trouble, is because, like I said, blending modes are based almost solely on black and white values and how, you know, like it interacts with black and how it interacts with white, each individual pixel and things like that. And so obviously when we throw complete black and complete white in there, you know, it's going to interact kind of in a funky way. But, you know, overlay, things like that. And so, again, it's kind of go through and see, you know, what each one does, you know, and you can see we've almost got kind of a retro, you know, look there, album cover or something, you know, whatever. You know, whatever you want to do with it. But you know, there's just all sorts of different things. So go through, you know, see what each one does, see how it affects your image, you know, see how you like it, because really, you know, it's personal preference in the end. You know, and so we'll go to I don't know, we'll go to overlay, you know. And so it's really just kind of that image, and you know, it's almost just pasted on there. You know, that's a fairly simple one. And so those are blending modes. Adjustment layers are there's really kind of two different ways to do it. You can go up here and you can go new adjustment layer. One of my favorites is always curves. Curves and levels do essentially the same thing, but I'm more of a fan of curves. So we'll just call this adjustment layer curves, hit enter, okay. And you can see now it's created this new adjustment layer. And that was kind of the roundabout way of doing it, you know, going up to layer and all that. So if we just hit backspace with that layer selected, then you can see over here we have this thing called adjustments. If you don't have that, go to window down to adjustments, you know, and it'll bring that up. But we're going to go over, you know, and you can see as you go over each of them, it tells you what it is. So we're going to go to curves and we're just going to click on it, and you see it's done that same thing. You know, if you want to rename it, you kind of double click on that there, you know, adjustment, hit enter. So you can see that's done the same thing. And you can see this is applied a layer mask by default in case you want to use it. Usually if I'm applying an adjustment, I do it to, you know, I do it to everything. And so we're actually going to jump back out here just a little bit. There we go. So each, you know, each one of these, like you can see brightness and contrast obviously has a different interface than curves does. So I'm just going to teach you how to use curves here really quick, because it's a good one to know. Curves is essentially, these are your blacks and these are your whites up here. And, you know, it can be a little bit tricky to see like how they correspond with each other at first, but if you drag it anywhere in here, you can create a new point and adjust it. And so you can see in here we're on RGB. So if you drag this up, you know, what it's doing is it's essentially increasing the white point of all of these, is what that's doing. And so, you know, what, it's kind of increasing the exposure, I guess you could say. You know, if you drag it down, you find you kind of have a little more contrast, things like that. You know, so it's, they're kind of, it can be kind of difficult to use. You know, drag it around to different places in there, see what it does. You know, you can drag it all the way down here and then down a little bit. You know, if you want to jump back to that straight line, just click this, you know, undo, and it'll jump back to the straight line. You can also do the same with just reds, you know, or, oops, you know, or just greens, blues, whatever, you know, but RGB should be, you know, probably what you end up using for the most part. But let's say I just want to apply it to this image. This is kind of another one that's, you know, not totally relevant to the list that we had earlier, but it's a good one to know. Because you can see right now, you know, wherever I move this, it's applying to the whole image. And so with this, you know, like with this selected, we want to make sure it's right above what we want to apply it to. So, you know, our image right here. And so with that selected, if we actually select this right here, you'll see it says this adjustment affects all layers below. You know, so click to, you know, like click to apply and, or I mean, click clip to cover layer, click to clip layer, I'm sorry. So click that and you'll see all of a sudden that, you know, this has now become underlined down here, you know, whatever our layer is, our image layer. And so, you know, since we don't have anything done here, you say, you know, okay, well, what did that do? And so, you know, if we take, you know, if we take that and we start moving around now, then you can see it's only applying to that image versus when it was off, you know, it applies to the entire, you know, to the entire canvas. So we'll keep that on, you know, because I want to darken that image down just a little bit, you know, and add another point, you know, and make it very, very contrasty there. So we'll kind of close that down. So now you can see that's an adjustment layer. And if we just click the eye view, then you can see, you know, kind of what that adjustment layer's done, you know, turn it on and off and things like that. And so that's how adjustment layers are used. That's really the best way to use those. Shape layers, we actually came across a little bit earlier when I created these rectangles, but we'll go over it a little more in depth. Is if we, you know, if we come over here just down below, like our direct selection tool and our path selection tool, and we click here and you hold the mouse button down, you can see we have all sorts of different shapes. In this case, we'll just use rounded rectangle tool. And so if I just come up here, you see we have that selected, and you know, I'll just kind of drag this, you know, drag this shape that I want. Well, you know, obviously it hasn't really done anything but create kind of this thin black line. Well, that's because if we go up here and you look at fill and stroke, you know, stroke has something on it and fill just has this red dash, meaning there's nothing there. So stroke, you know, oh, let's say, you know, we want kind of a blue border around this shape. So we'll do that. And then the fill, you know, let's make it, I don't know, let's make it yellow. So you can see now we've filled that, and it's a little hard to see that stroke. And so let's go in just right by the stroke 3 point, and we'll just increase that, and you see it'll make that larger. You know, if I go back to our selection tool, you'll see, you know, now we have this shape, but I want it below the text. And so again, we're gonna rearrange our layers, and we're gonna go down right below the text, and you'll see now we have, you know, that layer below the text. And so that's really, there's not too much to shape layers. You know, the custom shape tool is just, you know, is adding in, you know, just kind of different things. Like you can see up here with the custom shape tool, you know, there's now all sorts of different things, you know, we can create with that. So that's, you know, those are kind of fun ones to play around with. Again, it's just something you have to, you know, kind of work around and keep, you know, just keep trying new things in order to kind of learn what it does. And finally, there are layer comps. And so what layer comps do is it's a quick way to just jump between two different versions of, you know, like of a project or of an image that you're creating. And so if we go up to window and we go down to layer comps, you'll see it'll bring up our layer comps here, and last document state should be there by default. But you know, let's say, okay, I like, you know, I like how, you know, I like how that is. You know, that's my project. So if we just click on this new right here, you know, we can do that and say, we'll just keep it layer comp one. And then let's do position, and yeah, we'll keep that there. You know, you can jot down some notes if you want to. So let's do that. And then let's go ahead and, you know, let's select kind of our rectangles, and we will move them around here just a little bit. And, you know, if we shift select things, it'll select everything between, like the top and the bottom, it'll select everything between. Whereas if you click and hold down command or control on Windows, then it'll select just different layers instead of everything in between. So I'm just gonna select our text and then our rectangle there so I can move them together. And, you know, we'll drag them down here. And, you know, now I'm gonna go in and I'm gonna create another one, you know, and so actually before we do that, let's go in and let's turn off the red rectangle just to kind of illustrate. And so we'll click that new again, you know, and so visibility and position are checked. And so now we do that. And so you can see now we have, you know, this last document state, layer comp one and layer comp two. Well, if I click on layer comp one, you know, it just selects, it doesn't do anything. But if we click on this button over here, then you can see, you know, all of a sudden it's those changes I made. We can jump back and forth really quickly. And if you draw your attention down here to the layers box, then you can see that things change a little bit. Primarily, you'll just notice this eye right here on the red rectangle, because this doesn't show that things have moved, you know, but we did turn on visibility. And so you can see just how, you know, just kind of how that's changed. And so you can create two different versions very, you know, very quickly within the same Photoshop document. And so that's really all layer styles do. And so now the assignment that was that this is being applied for is to create a montage. And so with all of these different, you know, with all these different techniques, you kind of have to bring them all together, you know, to form that montage. You know, if we wanted, you know, like multiple pictures, let's say, you know, let's clean this up a little bit and just go through so I can, you know, see things a little bit better, make them, you know, a little more clear and things like that. You know, let's bring in one of our other images here and we'll drag it right on top. You know, so you can see, you can begin to, you can begin to position things around. And we actually don't want that right there. So let's see, oh, there it is. Release clipping mask. And so you can see we can position things around. You can begin to cut kind of people out, you know, either by, you know, either by selecting them, you know, and inverting that selection, you know, and then deleting, you know, out of that, things, you know, things like that. Or you can go in and manually erase them. And when I say erase, you know, of course we go and we use the mask tool. So you can see, you know, I create a new mask there with it selected, you know, with my brush on black, you know, you can see, and it looks like it's painting orange, but really, you know, it's just erasing that, or hiding it, I should say, is a better term. You know, and so we can kind of go around, you know, and you can change your brush, and so it kind of does different things. You know, you can see if we use that one, you know, how it's kind of doing some interesting erase marks there. You know, you can play with the brush properties, you know, and so spacing, spacing, you know, things like that. And so anything you can do with a normal brush, you know, you can do using the using layer masks. And so, you know, I'm just going to go in and I'm going to paint all of that back in, you know, just by switching my brush to white, you know, I'm painting that back in. And, you know, from there, it's just kind of, you know, moving them around, placing them on top of each other, below each other, things like that, and really just kind of getting the look you want. You know, this fill layer in the background, you know, that doesn't have to be a fill layer. You know, it can be another image that's, you know, created very large, things like that. So those are all the properties that were, that were part of this assignment. So I wish you the best of luck, and I hope that made enough sense.